now we're going to turn to some difficult ideas. And we're going to provide you a brief explanation of what is different about what we are doing and to orientate you to our purposes. More about the specifics of the grammar rather than the meanings of its meanings come later. We don't write about these ideas until right near the end of the second of our two volumes, Adding Sense. So by putting this video early on in the series, we are for a moment jumping to our conclusions. So we have four proposals.
So here's the first of our four proposals. We want to offer a generalized grammar that works across all forms of meaning. This is framed around the five functions of meaning that we call reference, agency, structure, and interest. By function, we mean the orientation or the purpose of a meaning. Whether the form of meaning is text, image, space, object, body, sound, or speech, or a multimodal combination of these, any and every meaning can always be parsed for all five functions. Any meaning, every meaning, always refers to things in the world. These things can be entities or actions, they can be a single instance or multiples, captured in concepts, they can have properties such as their qualities or their quantities. But meaning also always involves agents who take the roles of self, other, or thing in events involving different modulations of conditionality such as assertion or requirement or just possibility. Every meaning has a structure which gives it coherence, and this structure is a matter of design and the result that has both material aspects in the physical object of the meaning, the sound or the piece of text or the object, but also ideal aspects in the way in which we think about these things. Meanings are always also made in context, shaped by positions in time and place, whether materialized by likeness, directness, or abstraction, and using material media for their making. Finally, meanings express interest, whether in an explicitly rhetorical way or meanings that are not so explicit. These are just a few aspects of the pattern language that we develop in this transpositional grammar.
Our second proposal. The humanities and social sciences were dominated in the 20th century by something that is frequently called the language turn. Among its most famous protagonists were Ferdinand de Saussure, the founder of structural linguistics, and of course Ludwig Wittgenstein, a towering figure in the movement that came to be known as analytical philosophy. To understand language is to understand how we mean, Saussure and Wittgenstein would say. Language, according to this view, is the key to meaning, the pivotal point for understanding how we as humans think. It is also in this view what makes us different from animals. What we want to propose is an ontological turn, and by this we mean there are meanings in objects, in our bodily feelings and actions and spaces, and these can be represented in image, in text, in sound, and in speech. And even text, image, sound, and speech, these are not simply symbolic. They are more than just signs. They are material practices, things that we do with our bodies, in space, and with the help of objects. This we call ontology, the things we, as a species, do to mean, and the material objects and practices we use to give meaning. There is nothing special in language because the meanings, even of language, are in the traffic in and between language and the world. We don't even want to use the word language because in our parsing of the forms of meaning, text and speech end up being so very different. There are two aspects to this ontological turn for us, a philosophical aspect and a technical one. The philosophical one takes us back to the Greek roots of the word. Ontology is the analysis of being in the world. There's also the technical meaning these days, one that arises from the era of digital representation and communication of meaning. Digital media, mechanically speaking, run on meaning schemas that computer scientists call also ontologies. This grammar is itself an ontology in this sense, a meta-schema for tying together digital ontologies.
And now proposal three. Meanings are not a static system of nameable things, nouns versus verbs in texts, points versus vectors in image. They are systems of movement where nouns and verbs can be made into each other and points can be on vectors. Ferdinand de Saussure was the founder of structuralism in linguistics. And this idea was later transferred to anthropology, sociology, and other areas of the humanities and the social sciences. His idea was that the meaning is in the system. Words sit together in a system of contrasts, that is language, and the system repeats itself each time we speak. Most famous among his successors is the linguist Noam Chomsky, who argued that the system in our language is the system in our brains. After that, there was a reaction, famously this time argued by Jacques Derrida. The reaction was called, unimaginably perhaps, for want of a more positive descriptive term, post-structuralism. All there is, Derrida and his followers said, is repetitions. But the repetitions are never the same. It's as if we're lost in a swamp of irreducible differences, and the best we can do is trace the circumstantial connections of one meaning to another. Now, with a transpositional grammar, we're saying something different again. The meaning of a function is its readiness to change, the imminent possibility of it becoming something different. So if structuralism is about stable categories in a systemic relation, and post-structuralism is about the irreducible differences and changes that happen in the world all the time, a transpositional grammar is about the patterns of those movements. We're not interested to formalize the structures of meaning into categorical objects that have been frozen for the moment of analysis. Rather, we're interested in the patterns of their becoming, what they have been and what they're begging yet to become. Transposition is a kind of a likelihood, it's an impatience. It might be a risk, it's a danger, it's a possibility, it might be an opportunity, an impossibility, a shock, a hell, a utopia. All of these things are moving from one to the other. And of course, it's just really about the range of possibilities for movement.
Now for our fourth proposal. One of the great tensions in modern Western philosophy is between the antinomies that are loosely called materialism and idealism. In the two volumes that go with these videos, we also give Indian, Arabic, and indigenous examples. Here are the archetypical protagonists. On the one hand, we have John Locke, who was interested in how our subjecthood is constituted from an objective world. He focused on the naturalness of our knowledge derived from our senses. Human beings, Locke famously said, are a tabula rasa, a blank slate. We are what we have learnt from material experience. For Locke, the material takes priority over the ideal. Now, here is René Descartes. He was more interested in the relationship of subjecthood to the world. Human knowledge is in its basic structure innate, he said. The mind is the source of all meaning. Cogito ergo sum, Descartes said. I think, therefore I am. The world is the ideas in my head. If for Locke the material takes priority over the ideal, then for Descartes the ideal takes priority over the material. Of course, both Descartes and Locke are smart enough for their ideas to be more carefully qualified than this very rough generalization. Now, it would be fair to say that these are just a whole lot of dead white men, and of course you'd be right. These are the kinds of people who have dominated the conversation in Western thought. And if Western thought is flawed, it is in part because these kinds of people are flawed themselves. In these videos and the two volumes of our transpositional grammar, we include others. We also find versions of this conversation going on among First Peoples and in India and in the Arabic-speaking world, to give just a few examples of the places we want to take you on this journey into the meanings of meaning. We also want to bring back into people's consciousness some great and unjustly neglected thinkers, like the great theorist of semiotics, Victoria Welby, and the philosopher, Edith Stein. Across the dichotomy of the material and the ideal, of subject and object, we want to propose that everything has a material aspect and an ideal aspect. There is no meaning in the material without there also being meaning of the ideal. Though at times the material can exceed the ideal, what we call the undiscovered, and the ideal can exceed the material, which is the imaginable.